안녕하세요. 서울시향의 온라인 콤미공 클래식 음악 연구가 장금입니다.
안녕하세요. 클래식 음악 칼럼니스트 유정우입니다.
네, 지난 시간에 저희가 데이비드 이 지휘자님을 모시고 지휘자의 모든 것이라는 컨텐츠를 만들어서 올렸는데요. 정말 많은 분들의 피드백이 있었어요. 너무 내용이 좋았다. 그리고 데이비드 이 지휘자님께 정말 좋아요와 많은 댓글을 남겨주셨거든요. 그 비디오를 통해서 정말 저희가 알수 없었던 그 지휘자님들의 그런 이야기들 들어볼 수 있어서 너무 좋았는데요. 이 여세를 몰아서 오늘 또 특별한 분한 분을 이 자리에 모셨습니다. 아마 한국에서 오늘 저희가 모실 분을 모시고 하는 음악 콘텐츠가 있을까 싶을 정도로 상당히 저희에게 이 프로그램 자체에 대해서 자신감을 심어줄 만한 그런 분입니다. 네, 서울시향의 공연기획 자문역이신 볼프강 핑크님을 모셨습니다. 자, 인사와 소개 부탁드리겠습니다.
My name is Wolfgang Fink. I'm the artistic advisor of the Philharmonic Orchestra since November 2018, when I arrived for the first time in Seoul to work with the orchestra. I've been to this country before in 2016 with the French orchestra, and I was overwhelmed with the fantastic audience, musical audience, and I was really very pleased and felt very honored to be invited to be this orchestra's artistic advisor.
<Thank
you.
환영합니다. 예, 우리가 무대에서 보는 사람은 지휘자, 연주가
웃음> 네.
이렇게 무대 위에 올라오시는 분들만 보게 되지만, 사실은 이 한편의 공연을 올리기 위해서는 정말 많은 분들이 무대 위에서 땀을 흘린다라는 거를 우리가 어렴풋이는 알고 있습니다만,
네.
하물며 이 오케스트라의 뭐 1년 동안 아니면 뭐 특정 기간 동안에 프로그램을 이렇게 다 짠다는 건 정말 그 대단한 일인 것 같은데요.
네.
정말 이 무대 뒤에서 한 해의 프로그램을 짜면서 어떻게 보면 오케스트라를 뒤에서 이렇게 모든 걸 움직이고 조직하시고 이렇게 계획을 짜시는 이런 참 엄청난 일을 하시는 분을 만날 수 있다는 거
네.
정말 대단한 영광이고 아주 기쁨인 것 같습니다. 오늘 정말 재밌는 시간이 될것 같은 그런 느낌이 많이 드는데요. 우리가 그럼 이런 프로그램은 과연 누가 다 짜는 건가?
네.
아주 그 궁금해할 수밖에 없는데요.
네.
이게 어떻게 보면은 서울시향의 한 해에 티켓 판매율에도 굉장히 그 중요한 역할을 하기 때문에 어떻게 보면 가장 중요한 일을 하고 계시는 분이라고 할수 있겠습니다. 이 볼프강 핑크 선생님은 2018년부터 서울시향의 공연 기획 자문역으로 이렇게 일하고 계신데요. 한 번도 이렇게 쉽게 뵐수 없는 분을
네.
오늘 이렇게 뵐수 있는 영광스러운 시간이 된다고 생각합니다.
네. 정말 이 시국에 참 어려운 시국인데, 코로나를 뚫고 한국에 오셨습니다. 또 한국에 어떻게, 언제 도착하셨고, 또 어떤 일정으로 오셨는지요?
For this particular stay, I came 4 weeks ago.
Okay.
Did 2 weeks of quarantine.
어.
And I'm here for these last concerts with music director Osmo Wenske. This was a very, very difficult season with a lot of changes. So I wanted to be there and to see how the orchestra works under these very difficult circumstances. And I'm very pleased to, I've always, I already saw one concert on November 1st, which was really excellent. And it was good to see that the orchestra is in good spirits
Ah, great.
despite the very, very difficult situation.
예, 정말 이렇게 어려움을 뚫고 한국까지 오셔서 우리와 이렇게 함께하고 계시기 때문에 너무 정말 감사하다는 생각도 많이 든데요. 정말 모시기 어려운 분인 만큼 얼마나 대단한 분이길래
네.
서울시향이 이렇게 모셔서 한 해의 그 살림을 이렇게 다, 이렇게 계획하게 만드셨는지 정말 이분의 그 양력이랄까, 거쳐오신 예술적인 업적들, 이런 것좀 알고 싶은데요. 장금 선생님 좀 소개해 주시죠.
네. 아, 정말 목을 가다듬어야 될 정도로 정말 이력이 너무나 화려하신 분이십니다. 제가 하나하나 소개해 드리도록 하겠습니다. 독일 남부 태생이시고요. 음악학, 철학, 교육학을 전공하셨어요. 학생 시절부터 남서 독일 라디오 방송국 스튜디오에서 레코딩 프로듀서로 일을 하셨고요. 슈투트가르트 남부 라디오에서 편집자와 진행자로도 일을 하셨습니다. 프랑크푸르트 공연장 알테오퍼의 공연기획 팀장을 지내셨고 독일 최대 여름음악 축제인 슐레스비 홀스타인 페스티벌의 공연기획 팀장도 하셨어요. 그리고 프랑스 리옹 국립오케스트라의 공연기획 팀장, 또 오스트레일리아 시드니 심포니 공연기획 팀장 역임하셨고요. 뿐만이 아닙니다. 독일 밤베르크 심포니의 대표이사이시고요. 밤베르크 심포니가 주최하는 국제 구스타프 말러 지휘 콩쿠르를 이끌고 계십니다. 이후 다양한 문화 예술단체와 예술가를 위한 프리랜서 컨설턴트로 활동하시면서 강의 그리고 저술을 병행하고 계십니다. 그리고 아주 중요하게 서울시향의 공연기획 자문역으로 지금 활동하고 계십니다.
야, 정말 그 이 엄청난 국제적인 커리어를 이렇게 쌓아 오셨는데요. 아까 전에 저희가 이 녹화 준비하기 전에 장금 선생님과 유창한 프랑스어로 두 분이 대화 나누는 모습이 너무 우아하고 보기 좋았습니다. 근데 사실 그 우리가 이렇게 뭐 공연 기획 자문역, 다시 말해서 프로그래머, 이 한 해의 프로그램을 짜는 네. 프로그래머라는 직업에 대해 가지고 이렇게 소개를 받기는 했는데 구체적으로 우리가 프로그래머라는 얘기를 하지만 프로그래머가 어떤 일을 하는 직업인지 뭐 확실하게 알지는 못하는데요. 네. 그걸 조금 이렇게 그 여쭙고 싶습니다.
네.
Well, this is, you know, I did programming basically throughout my professional career mm-hmm. in very different circumstances yes, and yeah. in very different capacities. Mm-hmm. I started initially as a radio person. Mm-hmm. And my first program job was to do the ARD Nachtprogramm, which is the nightly program mm-hmm. For all of Germany. There's okay. one channel, mm-hmm. which at the time, which would broadcast from midnight until 6 a.m. in the morning, classical music.
Wow.
So you had to fill these six mm-hmm. hours with music.
Wow.
And that was actually a very, very challenging thing because you should present mm-hmm. Pieces that are attractive to the list for the listener.
Okay.
They shouldn't be too challenging.
Absolutely.
But they should be substantial. Mm-hmm. So that was a very good exercise mm-hmm. to start mm-hmm. with. But of course, that's very different. To program for a radio station
okay. mm-hmm.
than for an orchestra or for a festival.
Oh, yeah. mm-hmm.
Because, and again, I worked for a performing arts center mm-hmm. and I did the programming for very different series. Mm-hmm. I had a series for orchestra, visiting orchestras.
Yeah.
I did the programming for a contemporary music ensemble, which was our resident mm-hmm. ensemble.
Mm-hmm.
I did song recitals,
wow.
so all different kind of genres.
Yeah.
And of course, you had to respect the what the audience mm-hmm. in Frankfurt at the time
sure.
Knew and what they you had to meet their expectation mm-hmm. level.
Sure. Yeah.
And that was a very rewarding experience. But again. Mm-hmm. Very different than from a festival.
Mm-hmm.
If you program, mm-hmm. if you do programs for a festival, there you need to either have a huge variety mm-hmm. or, I mean, there are different strategies, of course.
Yeah.
But I think for the most important thing for a festival, mm-hmm. which makes a festival, is a kind of a focus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you have to offer a real interesting focus, a compelling programmatic focus that people can identify,
yeah.
then this is what this festival mm-hmm. is about.
Yeah.
So, and then of course, working for an orchestra is again a completely different mm-hmm. kettle. Mm-hmm. so it's very challenging and you can't say programmer is that.
Mm-hmm.
Programming is always dependent
mm-hmm.
on the presenter. It's mm-hmm. always dependent on the audience
yes.
you have.
Yeah.
And there is not one recipe mm-hmm. to follow. It is reacting to your audience.
Yeah.
And of course, very important, reacting to the musicians,
mm-hmm.
to the
mm-hmm.
artists
yes.
you're, mm-hmm. you're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
It should be always, you always need to respect. That's mm-hmm. very important. You need to respect what your what your artists, who your artists are, whether it is a soloist or whether it is an ensemble or it is an orchestra. What is most important as a programmer, you want to play to the strength of your artist, both of you, be it an individual artist or an orchestra.
Yes,
the orchestra should shine. And that's what we want.
Great.
예, 그러니까 이런 인연으로 지금까지 마이클 파인 그리고 상주 작곡가셨던 그 진은숙 선생님을 이어가지고 서울시향의 프로그래머로 지금 이렇게 재직 중이신데요. 정말 그 서울시향의 프로그램은 사실 언제나 우리나라 최고의 프로그램이었다, 오케스트라 프로그램이었다라고 생각되지만 우리가 1년 전에 바로 이 2020년에 이 서울시향의 프로그램에 대해 가지고 이야기를 할 때 저희들의 이야기를 아마 기억하실 겁니다.
네.
정말 이번 프로그램은 역대급이다.
그렇죠.
진짜 해외 오케스트라의 유수의 오케스트라들의 프로그램에 못지않다라고 얘기하면서 깜짝 놀랐고, 어떻게 보면 이 한 시즌에 이 프로그램 자체가 그 하나의 뭉뚱그려져서 하나의 작품으로 이렇게 우리가 여겨질 만큼 굉장히 인상적이었다라고 이렇게 생각하는데요. 그렇다면 이번 2020년 참 어떻게 보면 참 안타깝습니다. 예정됐던 프로그램들이
그렇죠.
이 코로나 때문에 많이 이렇게 취소가 되면서 그걸 다 경험할 수 없었던 게 아쉽습니다만, 이번 2020년 프로그램을 기획하실 때 어떤 부분을 주요 테마로 이렇게 생각하시고 어디에 이렇게 집중하시고자 했는지, 그 어떤 프로그래밍을 할 때 이번 시즌의 테마에 대해서 조금 여쭙고 싶은데요.
Well, the idea for the 2020 program, as it was planned and it was laid out in this brochure, was of course 2020 was a Beethoven year, so Beethoven played an important role. But of course, it was also Osmo Wenske's first year as a music director. These were the two main, let's put it that way, these were the two main factors or the starting point.
I see.
When I work with an orchestra and with a music director, the first thing the first conversation is, I talk to the music director. What do you want to do? What is your desire? That was a very interesting and very enlightening conversation, because that gives a lot of idea then what to do when the music director is not there. Beethoven, as I said, was a very important focus. But another focus which is underlying and which is always, should always play a major part in programming for an orchestra, is you want to sort of tell a story.
Yeah.
A story about what we do. So for instance, you will find in the 2020 program also a story of the symphony, the development of the symphony. And this is not that I start with, with a checklist and look, do we do everything right? During the planning circle, I look, did we already cover with regard to the repertoire? The closer I get to the end, I really then make lists and look what is actually on the menu, and then you refine it. But of course, these are the main starting point or the main issue with planning a season is you need a main focus, theme, and of course you need to respect what your music director wants to do. Because as I said before, you need to respect the personality of the artist.
Okay.
I admit this is different from what the orchestra did before. So when I was asked to be the artistic advisor of the orchestra, I wanted to see all the programs that had been done since 2005. So I got an idea what the orchestra did in this last 15 years.
Okay.
And that's, again, that's a very important starting point. You have to respect the history of the orchestra. Yeah. And I was really surprised and very pleased to see the variety that the orchestra had displayed over the last 15 years.
Yes.
There were many, many different things. But of course, I was also looking, what is missing? And because if I want to make a, if I want to contribute to this orchestra, I should think, I should give my experience to the orchestra. And what I think is very important for the orchestra is not only to present the core repertoire of the 19th century, which is basically what we do most of the time, but also to see what, where do we come from, where does this tradition come from, and where does it lead to. So I think that Haydn is the most, maybe the most underrated composer of music history, because literally the inventor of the modern symphony orchestra, symphony orchestra as we know it, is Haydn. And so we have three Haydn symphonies from three different periods of his life. And, you know, when I then made my list, I saw, okay, we did it, I think we did all right. We had five symphonies from the second half of the 18th century. So Bach, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, three Haydn symphonies, one Mozart symphonies. Then we have six symphonies from the first half of the 19th century. We have, of course, four Beethoven symphonies because it's the Beethoven year. But we also have Schubert, a rather unknown Schubert symphony, Schubert II, and Mendelssohn IV. Then we have three symphonies from the second half of the 19th century, Saint-Saëns Second Symphony and Bruckner III and Dvorak VII. We have three symphonies from the first half of the 20th century, Mahler, Sibelius, and Honegger. And we have two symphonies from the second half of the 20th century. So you see, there is really a history to tell if you look at this program in its entirety. So this is the idea behind, which is not necessarily, it is not necessary to know all these facts if you look at the program. I think what every programmer should do, each single program should be compelling and attractive. And but of course, if you create a season, it should be also coherent and something that is for the music lover and interesting for the music lover, but also important for the orchestra. And I think it is important that the orchestra is exposed to the repertoire in its entirety, not only you know to the 19th century or whatever. It should have the entirety of the repertoire always to deal with.
예, 정말 그 이렇게 말씀을 다 듣고 보니까 이 귀중한 2020 프로그램을 다 듣지 못한 게 정말 그 천추의 한인데요.
네, 맞아요.
근데 아까 그 장금 선생님께서 양력을 이렇게 핑크 선생님의 양력을 말씀해 주실 때 정말 전 세계의 수많은 오케스트라들이나 페스티벌을 거쳐 오셨고 프로그래밍을 하셨는데 현재에도 서울 시향 외에 다른 오케스트라를 이렇게 프로그램을 하고 계신 그런 단체가 있으신지 좀 여쭙고 싶습니다.
No, I work as a consultant for young artists. I'm in touch with a lot of young artists. My wife and I are connected very well in the, particularly in the German music world, and people are seeking advice because I've been in this industry, music industry, for well, nearly 40 years, so in different capacities. So, but my focus, main focus is the SPL.
프로그래밍을 하시다 보면 여러 가지 그 관여된 사람들 간에 이해가 조금씩은 충돌될 수도 있고 때로는 원하는 모든 것을 다 실현시킬 수 없을 때도 있는데요. 그런 때는 어떻게 대처하시는지요?
Programming is always a give and take. The beauty of programming for a radio program is, of course, there is only one opinion. The only limitation there is time. You have 1 hour.
Yes.
so that is easy. Programming with an orchestra is quite specific, because you have to work and cooperate and collaborate with a conductor and with a soloist. Mm. So most of the time you start with the conductor. And of course, very important is his availability.
Yes.
but given all these parameters that frame the program, if you talk program, you have, of course, a kind of an idea, or you should have, I think. If you invite a guest conductor or a soloist, you have something in mind what you want to have with him.
Yeah.
As I said, you play to his strength. You invite a person of whom you know he can deliver this particular repertoire, this symphony or this concerto in a very specific way. So to give you one example, we invited the cellist Christian Poltera, who is an excellent young cellist, but particularly the Lutoslawski is a fantastic piece, which he really delivers on a very unique level and in engagement. Actually, we had to postpone this because due to the corona crisis, he couldn't come. But he is supposed to come next year. And hopefully, he will do a different concerto, in this particular case, the Hindemith Concerto. And by chance, there was a broadcast in a German, a very important broadcast station, about this piece with different versions of the cello concerto by Hindemith. And the only young, recent, contemporary artist they choose was Christian Poltera. So you can expect he will deliver this concerto on a very, very high level. So this is how what your approach should be. You want to play to the strength if you program. But of course, sometimes you have a very specific idea in mind, and then it is a give and take. And the most interesting conductors and soloists are those who have an opinion on their own, of course. And so it's a very interesting conversation that makes, many people think you program your favorite pieces. That's not at all the case. This shouldn't be the case. You have a conversation with the artist, and then you try to find the best combination available.
야, 정말 이 들을수록 더더욱 이 흥미진진해지는데요.
네.
근데 사실 요즘은 우리가 공연을 보면은 SNS,
네.
SNS로 모든 그 공연 감상이 실시간으로 올라옵니다.
네, 맞습니다.
그렇기 때문에 아무래도 공연을 준비하시는 분들, 그리고 프로그램을 짜시는 입장에서는 이 SNS의 반응을 신경을 안 쓰실 수가 없으실
그렇죠.
텐데요.
네.
그 피드백을 어떻게 이렇게 하시는지, 그리고 또 한 가지는 그 중에서도 프로그래머의 입장에서 가장 기쁘게 생각하는 그런 반응들은 어떤 것인지 이걸 또 여쭈고 싶습니다.
네.
I think the most important feedback is, of course, the immediate reaction of the audience. Here I come to the country 6 times a year, so I cannot hear all the concerts. Whenever possible, I go to the concerts. For instance, with the orchestras I worked before, when I really lived with these orchestras, I went to all the concerts. So you get to know your audience, and you get to know how the audience reacts. What is so striking with the Korean audiences is their enthusiasm. So far, I think we didn't have concerts where the audience said, "What is this?" Sometimes you might have arguments or discussions with your colleagues from marketing and PR, because it is difficult, you know, to sell them what you have in mind. But I really trust that what we want to deliver and what we want to give is, regardless what the program is, you know, what the pieces are that are on the program, we trust and we try to deliver the best we can. And this is something what is so likable and lovable with this orchestra. They always try the best they can. So and when I see they enjoy performing, then that is the best reward.
네, 공연이 기획된 대로 잘 진행되면 너무나 좋겠지만 때로는 저희가 원치 않아도 돌발적인 어떤 변수를 만날 때가 있죠. 그래서 이렇게 여러 해 동안 공연을 기획해 오신 분 입장에서 이런 돌발 상황도 많이 맞아보셨을 것 같아요. 그래서 어떤 돌발 상황이 있으셨는지 좀 궁금하고, 그런 돌발 상황들을 대비해서 혹시 항상 플랜 B 같은 거를 따로 염두에 두고 계시는지 참 궁금합니다.
Well, unexpected situations, you cannot plan. That's the nature of an unexpected situation. So you need to be ready, or you need to be prepared to rethink everything, to go back to square one, and sometimes maybe even to compromise a very nice idea, which really looked nice on paper and you were looking forward to it, but then you have to accept, okay, this is an unexpected situation. We try to make the best out of it. So we try to give to find the best possible backup solution. Interesting question. Because when I started my working for this performing arts center in Frankfurt, the Alte Oper, in my first year, I was responsible for the song recitals. We had six song recitals, and three male singers and three female singers, all big stars. And the three female singers that were on the program, we were Barbara Hendricks, Barbara Bonney, and Julia Varari. And all three of them cancelled with 36 hours notice.
Oh, no.
So you had to find a replacement. And what I did, of course, you cannot, you know, to replace a big star is most of the time impossible. You cannot do that. I mean, these people, big stars are not available like that. So in this instance, I asked young singers, very young and upcoming singers, of whom I thought they are really very promising, to replace them. And luckily, they were very, very good. And, you know, all of them had a really good career afterwards. So another completely unexpected and really difficult situation, when I worked in Sydney for the Sydney Symphony, the audience was hugely looking forward to 2 weeks with Lorraine Mazel. Lorraine Mazel had a very good relationship with this orchestra, and he came every second, third year to Sydney. So he cancelled. He cancelled again with 2.5 weeks' notice. So and that was in August. I mean, summer season, summer festival season. Impossible to find a replacement of that reputation. So what I did, that was quite a bit, that was quite a risk. But I asked two young conductors at the time. I have to say, I think nobody knew them. One was Tugan Sokhiev, who later became, is now a big star in Russia. And the other was Yannick Nesse-Séguin. And again, there was a risk. I took a risk and it really paid off. So you need to be prepared also to take risks as a programmer. Okay, that was less programming, but replacing. It's both engaging artists and programming. You know, it's so you cannot. These are not two different things. The person who engages an artist, I think, should also be the programmer. That is one job.
야, 정말 이 흥미로운 참 리스크 네. 안고 이렇게 하는 참 그 대담한 그런 기획이 참 인상적이었는데 사실 돌발 상황 하지만 네. 이만한 돌발 상황이 있나 싶습니다.
그렇죠.
참 코로나 얘기하지 않을 수가 없는데요. 코로나 바이러스 때문에 아예 뭐 한 해의 프로그램 자체가 완전히 이렇게 그 돌발 상황으로 그렇죠. 점철됐는데요. 이렇게 그 올리지 못할 프로그램도 생기게 되고 또 연주자를 이렇게 초빙을 해와야 되는데 연주자 이동 자체가 불가능한 네. 이런 상황이기 때문에 사실은 코로나 때문에 굉장히 많은 힘든 시기를 보내셨으려고 생각합니다. 네. 그래서 올해 코로나라는 이 돌발 상황 속에서 가장 힘들었던 점은 어떤 것이었으며 또 거기에 대해서 어떤 방식으로 대응하셨는지 조금 여쭙고 싶네요.
Well, this is indeed one of the most challenging situations in my professional career. And to be very honest, also one of the most frustrating. Because of course, there are only limitations, basically.
Yeah.
Limitations with regard to the orchestra.
Yeah.
I mean, what we did actually, we reduced all the orchestras consequently we couldn't program big pieces or pieces that would require a large orchestra setup. But okay, that's doable. There's repertoire is huge, is big. But of course, the most difficult situation right now since the outbreak of the pandemic was that except for our title conductors, except for Osmo Wenske, our music director, and Markus Stenz, we didn't have guest conductors.
Oh, yeah.
We had, basically, he was on the way to the airport, Thierry Fischer, wanted to come in late August, early September. And we had to cancel because we had this incident with the orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
So this was really very frustrating.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to live up to this to this situation. Actually, but was it is of course frustrating because actually, if I would haven't done nothing for the 2020 season, you wouldn't. Nobody, the audience wouldn't have realized it. So this is. But you know, when we try to make the best out of it, and luckily, Osmo Wenske is a very passionate and very devoted music director. So luckily, he comes as often as his schedule allows it. So we can sort of cover a lot of what we had in mind, but of course with different programs.
Yeah.
But we sort of manage. And I hope we will in the future as well. Well, limitation is in fact a very, you know, creates new should create.
Yeah.
Limitation can also, I mean, make you feel, you know, hopeless or helpless. But a limitation creates also opportunities.
예, 근데 그 사람들이란 이 취향이 각각이기 때문에 다 다르긴 하지만
네.
그래도 전 세계 공통적으로 이런 레퍼토리는 먹힌다. 정말 좋아한다. 이런 게 있는가 하면 또 이런 레퍼토리는 거의 10중 8구 싫어하더라.
네.
이런 것들이 대표적으로 어떤 게 있는지 조금 여쭙고 싶습니다.
Well, that's let me answer in a not direct way. Everybody, most audiences, of course, like bolero. That's you know, and of course, between us, between programmers and artists, you speak of no-brainers. You know, you don't need to use your brain. You know, this will be a success. You know that. Although this is really a very difficult piece and a very demanding piece, if you want to deliver it on the highest possible level, Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto is a piece that is always welcome with the audience, and of course, you know, This is very seductive, so to speak, to think of these pieces. Yeah. You know, you have applause is built in, so to speak. And of course, you should not look down on these pieces. You should program them.
Yeah.
But I always think they should be programmed in a reasonable way.
Mm-hmm.
In the same way, it should be coherent.
Yeah.
It should be more than just the immediate gratification.
Yeah.
So we try to create a balance.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I can understand that audiences sometimes wonder, why don't we have this particular piece or this piece, which I loved so much, on this year's program. And then if you tell these people, well, you just had them in last year, they say, really? But I wasn't there. Okay, of course. If they aren't there, then they cannot, you cannot do the same pieces over and over again.
Yeah.
So that at the end, every listener will hear them within 2 years. So it needs to be balanced. But generally speaking, I try to really look what happened last year and the year before last year, before last, and look that the popular pieces appear regularly, but not, as a routine.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
They should be, when they are presented, they should be really presented in a meaningful way. As I said before, I haven't experienced that in this country.
Oh, wow.
Okay, I don't have so much experience with these audiences. But interestingly, if you, speaking in more general terms, the least successful program that I programmed in Lyon, in France,
yes,
was a program with that started with Debussy Prélude à l'après-midi d'enfant.
Beautiful.
Second, Ravel, Scheherazade. Beautiful song cycle. And after the interval, Florent Schmidt, La Tragédie de Salomé.
Oh.
Admittedly, a rather unknown piece, although Florent Schmidt was the director of the Conservatoire à Lyon in many, many decades ago. But nevertheless. And with a French singer, Sophie Koch was our soloist, and a French conductor, Stéphane Deneuve, was the least popular program.
Oh, really?
And I couldn't understand it. And it was a fantastic experience with the audience that was there, and with the musicians. Everybody was pleased to perform these beautiful pieces.
Yeah.
But it was not a success with the audience. God knows why.
예, 참 정말 그 지난 40여 년간의 그런 그 커리어를 통해서 정말 많은 단체와 페스티벌 등을 함께 이렇게 일을 해오셨는데요. 이번 서울시향 굉장히 또 의미 있는 핑크 선생님께도 의미 있는 오케스트라라고 생각이 되는데 이 서울시향을 통해서 뭔가 추구하고자 하는 예술의 방향성 이런 것도 있으실 테고요. 또 서울시향과 함께 뭔가 만들어 나가고자 하는 그러한 일들이 있으실 텐데 한번 좀 여쭙고 싶습니다.
As I said, as the programmer, you are not independent. You have to bear in mind what the orchestra does best, but also to challenge.
Yeah.
So we basically want to continue a series of symphonies we have not yet discussed. The Sibelius symphonies with Osmo Wenske.
Yeah.
That is certainly a focus. And what, of course, was not possible during this crisis, the Mahler symphonies. We did number two and we did the reduced version of number four.
Yeah.
But it is difficult under these circumstances to do more Mahler.
Mm-hmm.
But Beethoven, Sibelius, and Mahler are actually the main focus of Osmar Wenske's interest. But nevertheless, I mean, he did much more already with the orchestra. We really want to focus on pieces that are challenging, challenge for the orchestra. And you will see that, you could see that last year we had at least two programs come to mind, actually three programs come to mind, where we had no soloists, we had just the orchestra. For instance, a program, would have been very, very interesting to listen to the main focus, or the theme was Prometheus.
Oh yeah, we remember
With Haydn, Liszt, Haydn, and Beethoven. Unfortunately, that didn't happen, but another program was where we really featured the sections of the orchestra with Stravinsky Symphony of Wind Instruments and the Vaughan Williams Fantasy on a theme by Thomas Tallis, which was just for the strings. And this is something that you will find also next year. And this is something we really think very strongly, both Osmo and I, that we really want to give the orchestra the opportunity to shine, and also to challenge them to play as an ensemble. That is so important for the orchestra. But of course, we don't do that only for the orchestra's sake. We strongly believe these pieces, where you feature just sections of or particular aspects of the orchestra, are also very interesting for the listener to understand and to get a better, to meet the musicians of the orchestra like if they were chamber musicians. That's something that is, I think, very important, or that is one of the strong parameters of our programming.
아직까지는 비밀이시겠지만은 2021년에 이제 다음 시즌에 프로그램을 그쵸? 어느 정도까지 지금 완성하셨으며 그 중에서 저희한테 조금만 맛보기로 이렇게 좀 귀띔해 주실 수 있는 그런 프로그램이 있으신지 여쭙고 싶습니다.
네.
This is actually a huge challenge, and for you know, we have not announced a season, the season, the 2021 season. Because we cannot predict the current how long this current situation will limit us, and we don't want to frustrate the audience. I think it is very frustrating if you present a season and then it doesn't take place. Either the concerts are cancelled or postponed or whatever. So our current strategy is the following: we will announce the next 4 months, end of this month. And for the time being, I already alerted all the guest conductors of the second half, or from April through the end of the year. If you come, could you... could you schedule 2 weeks of quarantine? So that is a big ask. But for the time being, I already have secured two guest conductors and soloists who will come, whatever the regulations
are. That's great.
But it's a challenge. And it might change. Everything right now is subject to change, which is... frustrating, but I think I'm quite proud of the program to be announced shortly until that we agreed upon in the last couple of weeks. I'm really very satisfied with the programs we have in mind to do between January and April. With Korean conductors or Korean resident conductors. And I think it's a very interesting and very program with a lot of variations. with the pieces that are well known, but also pieces maybe unknown. But I trust that throughout the season, people will realize the links and the connections that are in with these pieces. And as I said in the first place, you can rely, it will be the best quality we can deliver.
Wow.
박수 한번 쳐야겠다.
와, 정말 그 오케스트라의 공연이 이루어지기까지 이렇게 많은 분들이 열정과 어떤 그런 자신들의 능력을 모두 투입해서 이런 공연을 만들어 간다는 것을 이렇게 당사자분들과 직접 이렇게 만나서 대화를 나누면서 알아가게 되니까 정말 저도 벅찬 감동이 밀려오는데요. 이렇게 뭔가를 점점 알아간다는 거, 이것도 역시도 기쁘지만 내가 얼마나 몰랐던가 하는 거를 또 깨닫게 되는 과정도 또 소중한 것 같습니다. 정말 오늘 이 말씀에서 제가 예상했던 거를 훨씬 뛰어넘는 엄청난 감동을 이렇게 안게 되니까 정말 너무 감사하다는 말씀을 올리고 싶습니다.
Yes, I hope you will enjoy the programs we put together. And I repeat, we do the best we can to create interesting programs for the listener, for the curious listener. There's a famous quote by Mozart. Mozart was asked what his, you know, the purpose of his composing and his music making. And he said, I wrote for all kind of ears, except for the long ears. Which he means for those people who don't hear and don't want to hear. I mean, the long ears are, of course, the donkey. I hope we can achieve which is my actually the inner core of my involvement in music is to create programs and opportunities both for the curious listener, for the listener who just enjoys music, and also for the so he enjoys because it's a fantastic opportunity. He can experience something enlightening, something entertaining, but also what we want to achieve is to create a challenge for those listeners who want more and who want to discover constantly new things. It's like going, if you go to a museum, you don't want to see always the same Rembrandts or Van Goghs. You know them. And of course, some of them are not available. you have to go to Amsterdam or to Paris to see them. But you want a variety. You want something to look at which is pleasing, but also something when you go through a museum that really you come out from it, something has changed in the way you are looking at things, and something should change in the way you're listening. And that is our goal.
2021년도에 서울시향의 프로그램을 기대해 보면서 아쉽지만 오늘의 콤비공은 여기서 인사드려야 될 것 같습니다. 지금까지 클래식 음악 연구가 장금,
클래식 음악 칼럼니스트 유정우, 그리고 서울시향의 공연 기획 자문역이신 볼프강 핑크님이셨습니다.
감사합니다.
감사합니다.